Good morning. Welcome to Emmanuel United Methodist Church, where our mission is to help people find, experience, and share the love of God. Today is the fifth Sunday, and the day when we honor the Florida United Methodist Children's Home. There is information on your chair, and the Florida Conference budgets for $12 from each person in the Methodist churches in Florida to give each year. And that's a pretty nice and low dollars. But if you would like to give more, that would be wonderful. It's a great, great place. Our small groups will begin September 6th and 7th with a wonderful book study, Moses in the Footsteps of the Reluctant Prophet. The books are $10 for the large print and $14 for the regular book. We need all interested to order your books no later than August 13, which is coming up. You may call the church office, or you can use your Connect card that's in the pew rack there in front of you, and you can put that in the box when you're leaving. The lunch bunch will be held on Tuesday, August 8th at 11:30 at Beef O'Brady's, as usual. Please let Joan Sprague know if you would like to attend. Joan, bring your, there she is over there. So let her know if you're coming. Now let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Thank you. We have gathered together in the presence of God to offer our praise and our prayers. We come before God with confidence, knowing that even when we can't find the words, God's own Spirit is right here with us, praying for us and with us, giving shape to our wordless hopes and longings, and pleading for us before the throne of grace. So let us come with joy to offer our worship to God, who knows and loves us all. Let us stand together for our opening hymn, Come Thou Font of Every Blessing. People of God, what do you believe?
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From hence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated.
Will you please join me in prayer? O holy and gracious God, who follows us in our lives and leads us in our lives and is on either side of us, the one who is with us always, we come this morning grateful to come to worship you, to remember all that you have done in our lives, all the ways that you have brought us through difficulty, the ways that you have brought us joy, the ways that you have taught us what it is to follow Jesus. We thank you. And we ask, Lord, that you would help us be those who would share with others what it is to follow Jesus, to be undergirded by the Holy Spirit, to know that our Father in heaven loves us and has a plan for where we will spend eternity. It is love, an abundance of love, for which we know we are not worthy. And yet, you love us. You woo us to yourself. You teach us how to follow, and you bring us along day by day. And so we feel bold to come to you, to come and ask that you would be in the world today, in a world that is struggling with everything from climate change that has caused such enormous difficulty with heat, in the midst of wars near and far, in the midst of political strife, in the midst of just the difficulty of living our day-to-day lives, we come to you asking for your peace, for your rest, and for your help. Asking that you would help us learn how to navigate our daily lives in ways that reveal who you are to a world that is in need of you, that is in need of the salvation that comes from Christ and the need of the help that the Holy Spirit brings. And so we come to you, even though we may be mourning, we may be struggling, we may be uncertain, maybe even uncertain about you. And still we come, because you are the one who has the keys to life. Not only a life worth living here on earth, but a life beyond in eternity. We're grateful, Lord, that you would offer that life to us, that you would walk with us through those days when we are uncertain about how we go forward. Not because we don't want to, but because we don't know how to follow you. And so we ask that you speak to our hearts. You speak to the souls within us to help us, to guide us, to lead us in the ways that only you can. And all of this we ask in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
At this place in our worship, we honor our offertory time. Will you pray with me? Loving God, you call us to be not only givers, but also receivers of your gifts of grace. We believe that you will multiply our gifts to draw us nearer to your side. As we offer these financial gifts, we are grateful to be joined to the love of God. In Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. Our scripture this morning comes from Romans chapter 8, verses 26 through 39. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless moans. He who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For these God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed in the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those he predestined, he also called. Those he called, he also justified. Those he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all the things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall problem or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor demons, neither the present or the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us stand together for our next hymn, Every Time I Feel the Spirit.
Before I begin, I would like to extend an invitation to anyone who would like to come to our discussion time of Sunday school. Immediately after this service, actually at 10:45, we formally start. You don't need to have any preparation. You can just come, and we'll be talking about some interesting things today. Will you join me in prayer? Oh God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing unto you, our rock and our redeemer. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Now, there are lots of things that we consider as inseparable. I think of peanut butter and jelly, and Kermit and Miss Piggy, and soap and water, and pen and paper. I mean, there are lots of things, examples that we could give. That's just to name a few. It seems we humans love to think of things in pairs rather than single items. After all, we call pants, pants. It's you know, plural, right? Well, I did a little research and I found out why. Apparently, when they first did pants, they did them as two separate pieces. You had the right leg and you had the other leg. And so you put on one leg and tied it up, and then you put on the other leg and tied it up, and that was a pair of pants. So I guess it makes sense, right? Apparently shirts were made in all in one piece at that time, and so they didn't have that trouble of what to call it. They weren't called a pair of shirts. So in the common pairs we think of, though, we know that each part can be separate. You know, we can eat peanut butter separate from jelly if we want to. But for all of these, but there are others that where the things are plural, we call them plural, but they're not. And they're not separate either. Scissors, sunglasses, tweezers, regular glasses. For all of these, they are inseparable because that's how they were created, rather than by tradition, like with salt and pepper. So we do tend to think of the body and the spirit or the soul of a person as inseparable. But are they really? I have the ashes from my father at home, and I will soon be placing them where he asked that I put them. And I don't consider that that's my dad's body. That's not where my dad is. Yes, it's what is remains in ashes of the body that he had. But when I think of my dad, I think of my dad as being with Jesus in paradise, wherever that is, and however we are when we're with Jesus together at that time, as he told the thief on the cross, he would be that day. He said, I promise you today you will be in paradise with me. And so we have to begin to ask the question, what is truly inseparable? Now, our verses of our text today continue on from where we ended last week in Romans 8. The opening words, in the same way, means it's continuing the discussion of the Holy Spirit and the Holy Spirit's role within our lives. At the end of last week, we heard that we groan inwardly, yearning for our adoption to sonship, that includes everybody, for which we wait patiently. So likewise, in today's text, he speaks of the Spirit as well. How the Spirit intercedes for us in prayer when we do not know how to pray. I don't know if you've ever been in that place where you were so overwhelmed with what was going on in your life, you had no way to pray. You had no words to be able to pray. And that's when the Holy Spirit takes over and prays for you, prays for us. And with that being the work of the Spirit, part of the work of the Spirit to help us pray when we cannot, the Spirit utters wordless groans in intercession for us. And it is believed that, you know, it is inseparable from the prayer that we would pray if we could have. Except that in the Spirit, he knows the mind of God, and God knows the mind of the Spirit, and the Spirit's intercession is always going to be in accordance with the will of God. And I want you to know that if you're a little confused about in reading through the scripture, like how does this all belong together? It took me a minute to figure it out, more than a minute to figure it out myself. So I don't feel bad if you were going, what all these things have to do with each other? The abrupt transition from Paul's words about the Spirit's intercession to the work of God in the next sentence kind of feels like a directional change, a physical direction change. And what a direction it is when he says these words. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purposes. Now, this verse, believe it or not, is a controversial verse because there are many different translations of it that translate it, that make it more or less directly of benefit to us. So some of them will say that he does good that will help us, but some of them say, like this one does here, that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him. In other places, it says more like that for those who love him, he will work all things to good. And there are others that make it unclear as to whether that good is for us or whether that good is for others. Now, part of the issue is that Paul says, we know this. because I don't recall anywhere else in the Bible where it communicates this idea. And so if we know it, it must be something that he's teaching that may not appear elsewhere. The second is that due to the various translations, there are actually variations in what different Bibles say, different translations of the Bible say. So I rather lean on Dr. Ben Witherington, Reverend Dr. Ben Witherington, who perhaps says it best. He says that whatever this verse means, so meaning, however we finally translate it, because it's a hard verse to translate, it certainly does not grant exemption for the hardships of life. And a little farther along, he says, the point is that all things can be made to serve the end of our redemption. So he points us into looking at this is not necessarily that this is good that happens to us throughout our lives while we are here, but certainly will help us to come to the point of the redemption of our bodies at the resurrection. And I think of all of the things that God could do, that is something I want to make sure he does in my life. What about you? Yes, absolutely. And so from my view, in the next two verses where he talks about God predestines us, that he calls us, that he justifies us, etc., this is one of the verses that some will use to say that God only predestines some people to be able to be saved. And that's an extreme view. I just want you to know that. But there are some that do have that belief, that only some of us are going to be saved no matter what we do. We could come to God all day long, but he predestined just some of us to go to heaven. That is not the belief of the United Methodist Church. And in our Methodist understanding, we understand it that God predestines all people, no matter who they are, to be saved. His destination that he wants for everyone is to be saved, but they have to respond. And so then he calls all those who respond to his invitation. So everybody gets the invitation. The ones that respond to the invitation are the ones that go on to be justified and made right before him, and ultimately to be glorified. Now, theologians use a phrase to talk about Christ followers who are already redeemed but will not experience the fullness of redemption until they live with God in heaven. And actually, it goes beyond that in the sense that Jesus will have returned. The phrase is the already and the not yet, or the now and not yet. How does this work exactly? Well, as reported in the YorkshirePostToday.com website, a little girl in England, Josie Caven, was born profoundly deaf. Growing up, she felt isolated often because of her inability to hear. But that changed after receiving a cochlear implant during the Christmas season. At the age of 12, she heard clearly for the first time. Can you imagine? Never heard anything clearly until then. The first sound she heard was the song Jingle Bells playing on the radio because it was Christmas time. Was her hearing restored? Yes, completely. Was she hearing well immediately? Well, not really. Because you understand that because she had not heard most of the sounds that she was now hearing before, she had no idea what they meant, what they were, where they came from. Her mother said she's having to learn what each new sound is and what it means. She will ask, was that a door closing? And she has realized for the first time that the light in her room hums when she turns it on. She even knows what her name sounds like now, because she can now hear the S in the middle of her name. Seeing her face light up as she hears everything around her, her mom said, is all I could have wished for Christmas. As Christians, we're somewhat like Josie, because when we follow Jesus, we're only partway to our full redemption in Christ. Yes, we have been forgiven. We have been saved by God through Christ. We are saved by grace through faith. But it will not be completed until Jesus returns. Just as Josie's hearing was restored, but she still had more to go before she really could understand everything just by hearing it. Our redemption consists of the now and the not yet. Let me put it to you this way. When we are saved, you know, that moment in time when you said yes to Jesus. For me, I was 10 years old, went forward on Easter Sunday to kneel at the rail and say yes to Jesus at a Free Will Baptist Church in Oklahoma. And at that moment, God saved me. I was saved by faith. But it's also true to say that I am being saved by faith because each and every day we have the choice of whether we continue to walk in that path or not. And it's also going to be true that I will be saved by grace because when all of this works out and Jesus returns, I will be saved by faith in that moment too. And so will everyone that says yes to Jesus. So hopefully that helps clarify that. It's happening, it's a point in time, but it continues throughout our lives and into eternity. As Paul enters the next section, he begins with the question, what then shall we say in response to these things? Meaning all the things he's talked about before. And he asks this question in multiple chapters, in 4, 6, 7, and 9, as well as 8 that we're in right now. But before we can answer, before we could even think of an answer, he goes on to another question. If God is for us, who can be against us? If God is for us, who could be against us? He's reminding us that God did not even spare his son, but gave him up for us all. As he asks another question, how much more then will he also, meaning Jesus, along with God, graciously give us all things? Indeed, do we not receive from the hand of God? We do. It is God who justifies, he goes on to say. Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? For it's God who justifies. Now, when he justifies, we're not talking about justifying print on the left side of your page. We're talking about justification is being made right with God. Being made right with him. And when we are justified, which happens through Jesus Christ's death on the cross and what he did in giving himself on the cross for us to save us from all of our sins, what happens in that time, in that moment, is that we are justified when we say yes. We are made right. We are no longer in a state of sin in that moment. And that's an important moment in the life of every person. Because in every moment that we are justified, we are with God. We are with God. He is with us. But when we turn away, when we walk away, and find our own way, and we take up sin again, then we have turned away from God. And so we want to always be focused forward toward that justifying, living into the justification that he has given us. Now, understand, God forgives. So I'm talking about not the person who, you know, had a momentary slip and they did something that they shouldn't have. But the person who turns away and says, I don't want anything more to do with God. God's failed me. I don't want to do anything more with God. When we do that, even for a moment, we've turned away completely from God. And that's something we don't want to do. So since God is the one who justifies, he's the one that makes that allows that our response to be able to respond to his invitation. And when in that moment, when he justifies, How can anybody else condemn that? Because he is God of everything. If he justifies us, there is no one who can condemn us in that. No one. In fact, even in this very moment, and every moment since Paul wrote his letter, Christ Jesus has been at the right hand of God, interceding for the people of God, not condemning us. Amen. And the one who created us, the one who died and was raised again, the one who prays for us when we cannot pray for ourselves, wow, they don't condemn us either. Paul asked the real hard question then finally at the end. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? That sounds a lot like being inseparable from Christ, does it not? It does. Who shall trouble or hardship, persecution or famine, nakedness, danger or sword? Shall these things separate us from the love of Christ? It's fascinating that by tradition, these are considered the list of the sufferings of Christ while he was on earth. So he asks, who will separate us from Christ? But he lists these difficulties: hardship and persecution, famine and nakedness, danger or sword. We also suffer some of these things too. People across the globe suffer some of these things. Paul asks the question to answer the unspoken questions of Christians in Rome. The ones who are trying to figure out what happens to us. What happens to us in the future? Will we be okay? Because remember, Rome, the people who led in Rome were not friends of the Christian faith. But Paul is reassuring them and us that God will be present for us. That we're truly inseparable from Christ, except when we choose to walk away. In his June 2007 Christianity Today article called "Where Is God When It Hurts?", Philip Yancey recalled that 9 weeks after his car accident, which was very serious, he was invited to speak to Virginia Tech students in the wake of the tragic campus murders committed by Sung Hui Cho in mid-April that year, 2007. And in the midst of his sermon, Yancey reflected on the accident and offered these words of insight, putting pain in perspective. He said, "I'm wearing my neck brace because I broke my neck in an auto accident. For the first few hours as I lay strapped in the bodyboard, medical workers refused to give me pain medication because they needed my response. The doctor kept probing, moving my limbs, asking, 'Does this hurt? Do you feel that?' And the correct answer for both he and the doctor was supposed to be, 'Yes, it hurts, and yes, I can feel that.' He said each sensation gave proof that my spinal cord had not been severed. Pain offered proof of life, of connection, the sign that his body remained whole. In grief, love and pain converge," he said to the students and the faculty. He said, "Sung Hui Cho felt no grief as he gunned down your classmates because he felt no love for them. You feel grief because you have a connection. Some of you have had closer ties to the victims, but all of you belong to the body to which they belonged. They were all students and faculty and other kinds of workers for that university." And he said, "When that body suffers, you suffer. Remember that as you cope with the pain. Don't try to numb it. Instead, acknowledge it as a perception of life and love. Friends, the pain these persons were feeling was due to being an inseparable part of the same body of students and faculty. Even without knowing those who died, they experienced the pain of knowing that it could have happened to any one of them. because they all were at the same university. No matter how tenuous the bond between us in a particular group of people, when the group experiences hardship, experiences this kind of event, it is experienced by us as individuals too. Now, as we look at the last section, Paul answers his question, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall all of those things, hardship, etc.? And his answer to it is no. In fact, in some Bibles, it is emphatic. It has an exclamation point after the no. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us, meaning God. Paul goes on to say, for I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Paul looks at a completely different idea of what could be against us. Here he mentions mostly a paired set of opposites, where I think he's telling us, no matter what happens in any of these things, God is going to be present. When he talks about in death and in life, God is going to be present. When he talks about angels versus demons, where they go, God is present. In the present and in the future, God is going to be there. Regardless of the powers who rule on the earth, God is above them all. Whether we are at the highest heights or the deepest, deepest depths, physically or spiritually or emotionally, God is there, for there is nothing in all of creation that can stand between us and God and the love of God in Jesus Christ. We are inseparable.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Paul wants the Romans and we today to know that God cannot be constrained by anything. We have limits to what we can do. But God, my friends, God does not. For he is God. And he will be wherever we are. And he will not allow anything in all of creation to separate us from his love. Forever. We can be assured that God does not and will not ever lose sight of us. For even if we should turn away from him, he will continue to pursue us. In the same way that he wooed us to himself in the beginning, he will do it again. He will always be with us, even when we can't feel that he's there. Because that happens for us a lot sometimes. No, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit has claimed us as his own. And in this text, we see that Trinity, in all three persons of the Trinity in this text. And we don't see that a lot. And what has happened, I think, over time is that we have begun to let go of the Holy Spirit. Because, you know, we talk about Father, the Father's our creator, and we can get around that. Yeah, he created us. And the Son is the one that came to save us. Oh, he died on the cross. That's something I can understand. But the Holy Spirit, like, where is he? I mean, he's supposed to be in us. Where is he inside here? Is it in my heart? Is it in my head? We don't connect somehow. But we see each person of the Trinity in action for us in these verses. We have the benefit of belonging with and to our triune God, from whom we are the only ones can separate. God, on the other hand, will always be the shepherd that looks for the lost sheep. In the book, Healing the Masculine Soul, Gordon Dalby says that when Jesus refers to the Holy Spirit as helper, he uses a Greek word, paraclete, that was an ancient warrior's term. He said Greek soldiers went into battle in pairs. So when the enemy attacked, they could draw together back to back covering each other's blind side. One's battle partner was the Paraclete, the same name we use for the Holy Spirit. Our Lord does not send us to fight the good fight without our battle partner, the Holy Spirit, who will cover our blind side and fight for our well-being. So, Paul has consistently placed the Holy Spirit and the Spirit's work before us in the chapter of Romans, in chapter 8 of Romans. And it's truly a gift, for he had taught us how to think about and interact with the Holy Spirit as well as the Father, whom he calls God, and the Son. When we leave out one or more of the persons of the Trinity, we lose the fullness of the relationship that God intends for us. And I don't know about you, but I need every bit of the help that God can give every day, pretty much. There are times that I am weak, and then times that I don't know how to pray because I'm just overwhelmed. There are times when I can be forgetful about the many ways that God has helped me, guided me, forgiven me, and made me stronger. And this week, friends, I think we need to do a little more than what I usually ask, because these teachings are so critical to our walk in Christ. So I suggest that you go home and sometime this week sit down and just read the whole chapter, just chapter 8 of Romans, just one chapter. It's not all that long. And you can do it in one sitting easily enough, but you don't have to. But then I'd like you to sit down and think about the last few months and write down ways that you have experienced God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, however you experienced him, how God has helped you and encouraged you, guided you and protected you, helped you to pray when you didn't know what to say, and never let you be separated from his love in Christ through the Holy Spirit. And then I'd like you to spend some time in gratitude and praise to God for all that you've received from his hand. Because sometimes we don't necessarily connect everything that's happening in our lives with everything that happens in our faith. And when you write that down, hang on to it. Because there's going to come a time when perhaps you can't see that God is at work in your life. And when you need a reminder that God is always present and working in your life, I want you to come back to this and look at the ways that he was helping you. And perhaps you're just missing where he is right then in that moment. And this will remind you. Friends, our God loves us more than we can possibly know, more than we can possibly fathom even. And he wants us to always be ready for him, always be ready in our faith, never to turn away from him. For life here on earth, it's just the prelude to our eternal life with him. Amen?
Hallelujah.
Let's pray. Oh God, we thank you that you have provided in such ways for us. We thank you for this message from Paul, who could so clearly see your nature and be able to explain to us how we work with you, how we are related to you, how we are inseparable from you. And we ask that you would help us day by day to make the choices that continue to make us inseparable, to make the choices that draw us closer and closer to you each day, to make the choices that undergird our lives because you are present. All this we ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, now if you will stand as you are able, we're going to sing The Gift of Love, which is number 408 in the hymnal, and we'll be doing all those verses.
Bravest fire, and now
as we go from this place, please receive this benediction. Wherever you go, God is sending you. Wherever you are, God put you there. God has a purpose in you being right where you are. Jesus Christ, who indwells us through the Holy Spirit, he wants to do something in and through you. Believe this and go in his grace, his love, and his power. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and all God's people agreed and said, Amen.